Can we get a round of applause again for Hope and Karen for bringing us here together? Where hast thou been, sister? The first of the three witches in Shakespeare's play, Lady Macbeth asks her sisters. Killing swine, the second witch says. And in this response, which is made very casually, matter-of-factly, is signaled both a kind of monster of femininity and a prefiguration of what's to happen shortly in the play. This dialogue occurs in Act One. And of course, as you know, Lord Macbeth, with the connivance of his wife, Lady Macbeth, who kind of puts him up to it, murders King Duncan and his men as they lie sleeping. They stab them to death, Lord Macbeth stabs them to death. And Lady Macbeth, in this pivotal scene, to convince herself that what she's doing must be done, she intentionally suppresses her feelings of compassion. And she says, "Come, you spirits that assist murderous thoughts, make me less like a woman and more like a man, and fill me with head to toe, from head to toe, with deadly cruelty. Thicken my blood and clog my veins so I won't feel remorse, so that no human compassion can stop my evil plan or prevent me from accomplishing it. Come to my female breast and turn my mother's milk into poisonous acid, you murdering demons, wherever you hide, invisible and waiting to do evil. Come, thick night, and cover the world in the darkest smoke of hell, so that my sharp knife can't see the wound it cuts open, and so heaven can't peep through the darkness and cry, 'No, stop.'" Although it's Macbeth who draws the knife over the throats of the sleeping men, we think of Lady Macbeth, who's the midwife to her filial husband's ambitions, as the greatest monster of the play because she intentionally quashes her human capacity for emotion. Now, in order to kill a whole lot of persons, whoever those persons are, we need ways of talking about them, discourses, myths, stories, modes of representation to justify the violence and the oppression. Vis-a-vis animals, these discourses go back many thousands of years. Aristotle, 2,500 years ago, for example, who wrote about human slaves and animal slaves, said there's a community of interest and a relation of friendship between master and slave. And this ideology was used to justify human slavery for many thousands of years. We find the same ideology in circulation today. A slave is a living tool, Aristotle said, and we find Barbara Kingsolver, one of the most distinguished writers, female writers of the present, describing animals as four-legged tools. Quote, "They're human property, not just legally, but biologically." We find these justifications, these rationales for what we do to animals, as I say, rooted in ancient traditions and stories and philosophies. And there's a lot of parallel between the way we talk about non-human animals and the way slave owners rationalized their control of human slaves. For example, Thomas Dew, an apologist for human slavery, said, "Liberty has been the heaviest curse to the slave when given too soon." And then in 2006, Michael Pollan says, "Liberation is the last thing such a creature, say a farmed animal, wants." So we have this ideology. Slaves like to be happy, and animals, of course, like to be exploited and consumed. Now, although these are ancient rationales, in the capitalist era, we find much more kind of cultural complexity. Animals have always been associated in Western culture with the feminine, and by the same token, meat economy has always been associated with men. Carol Adams writes a lot about this in her work, especially Sexual Politics of Meat. So here are just a few ads suggesting a link between meat eating and masculinity. Even in this ad, of course, Marlboro Country, which isn't an ad for an animal product, but for a cigarette, the cowboy, famous cowboy from those images in the 60s, 70s, is shown dominating non-human animals. It's part of the common currency of the society. Well, under capitalist relations, we find that these cultural mediations to help us to justify our violence towards other beings, as I say, has become quite complex, and they become entangled in the contradictions of capitalism, which continually requires new modes of culture, new cultural practices, new ideologies to legitimate the violence. 1943, this is a very famous image, I'm sure many of you have seen, of, by Norman Rockwell, of one of the four freedoms. This is during the war, war effort, and Rockwell's Freedom from Want, of course, pictures this benevolent patriarchal figure, kind of a priest-like figure in benediction over the Thanksgiving turkey. And the turkey is has no subjectivity. It's what Carol Adams would call an absent referent. But you can see here an image of plenty, of national perseverance and national strength. That's what this is representing. It's also representing a patriarchal image. Now, if we fast forward to 2012, we find a new mode of legitimating the meat system through gender. So this was a photograph that appeared in the New York Times Magazine of Kama Davis from the Oregon Meat Collective. And there she is with a decapitated, the head of a decapitated pig, and the pieces of the pig's body splayed out over the table. And now we have an image of the woman. There's no need for a man at the head of the table. She has assumed the position of power, and she's like the chief nurturer, or nurturer-chief, really. We also find this new discourse, such as Lily McCallu says. McCallu was a journalist, or is a journalist, who then decided to take up hunting, Learning to Hunt My Own Dinner is the subtitle, and in that book she describes hunting as the final frontier of feminism. Now, that kind of raises a very interesting and difficult philosophical question. And the reason is, as I say, historically, women have been associated with the life principle, with nurturance, and men have been associated with violence against animals and against other human beings, right? It's a long, long story about men controlling the means of warfare and the hunt and so forth, and using that power to dominate women. And that's one reason why feminists historically, such as Charlotte Perkins Gilman, who wrote the Yellow Wallpaper, such as Frida Kahlo, the Mexican painter and muralist, who depicted herself in this painting as a wounded deer, have always played around with images and discourses of equality between women and non-human animals. So this is a kind of new phenomenon and one that's quite disturbing. So because I have about 100 slides to get through, I'm going to just lay out my argument very briefly. So my argument is that women in the sustainable agriculture and locavore movements are regendering the meat economy, casting their control, domination, and killing of non-human animals as a feminine and sometimes even feminist practice. And they're doing this by associating animal agriculture with discourses and themes of maternalism and natality. And this has a very, very important role to play in the new legitimation of violence against animals. I want to thank Robert Grillo of Free From Harm, his wonderful website, for bringing this to my attention just last week. There's a new movie coming out, or maybe it's even out, called Kale Versus Cow by Diana Rogers, in which it's this whole argument about how you know, vegetarianism and veganism are actually anti-ecological, and how we need to eat animals. And that's Diana Rogers. And as part of the marketing for this, here's Diana Rogers nurturing this beautiful lamb. Why is this going on? Just very, very briefly, two reasons. One is that capitalist agriculture is in crisis and therefore objectively requires new modes, new means of legitimating itself. And secondly, white middle-class women have been stymied for decades in their quest for equality. The Me Too movement is a very recent development and an incredibly healthy one. But this phenomenon they're going to be talking about today, what I call femivorism, as I'll explain, predates, of course, Me Too. And for some women who feel quite frustrated, especially, say, white, middle-class, upper-middle-class women who have been promised a kind of equality and not yet received it, there's a kind of displacement of their rage, is my feeling, onto non-human animals who they can control and feel a sense of empowerment over. So let's just very briefly look at the first one. Capitalist agriculture is in crisis. Now, without going into much detail here, speciesism, as I conceive it, is a global system of production, a mode of producing human life. It is now indistinguishable in many ways from the capitalist world system, which is itself in crisis. So we have destabilization of the atmosphere from agriculture, destruction of the biosphere, species extinction, erosion of our democracies, growing epidemiological threats like avian flu, and ethical contradictions. You know, educated so-called consumers now want to feel like they can have their meat and their conscience too. So these are contradictions that need to be worked out. Hence, the solution about 10 years ago is Michael Pollan's incredible breakthrough bestseller, Omnivore's Dilemma, in which he spends a good part of that book not only defending animal agriculture, but attacking animal rights. If you read that book or read it again, you'll find that much of it is an attack on animal rights. So locavorism, meat restaurants, there's this huge renaissance in the meat economy. It's an explosive thing going on here, and the locavore, sustainable agriculture movements are driving it. There's a huge amount of profit to be made from it. However, at the same time, there's a legitimation crisis. That's simply a fancy way to say that people do not think of meat and animal products in the same way they used to, and they need new rationales for it. In 2012, the New York Times, actually the magazine, ran this contest called Defending Your Dinner. And they invited readers to say, tell them why it's ethical to eat meat. Now, that's the first time in human history, right, that humans have, as a whole society, begun to ask that question. So that is that's a sign both of the progress that the animal rights movement has made and also the seriousness of the ecological crisis. So let's go. I want to look at what happened to feminism here because it's a very important part of it. I want to begin with this short video of Helen Reddy singing what became the feminist anthem in the early 1970s called I Am Woman.
I am woman, hear me roar, in numbers too big to ignore, and I know too much to go back and pretend. 'Cause I've heard it all before, and I've been down there on the floor. No one's ever gonna keep me down again. Whoa, yes, I am wise, but it's wisdom for the pain. Yes, I paid the price, but look how much I gained.
So, right, isn't that wonderful? Well, during the late 60s, early 70s, particularly early 70s, then you have women, feminists, anti-war people beginning to be interested in vegetarianism. Then we have, of course, the Moose Wood Cookbook, which is still one of the best-selling cookbooks of all time in any language, and Diet for a Small Planet by Frances Morrow LePay. There are other feminists who played a role in kind of bridging the gap between speciesism and vegan politics or animal rights politics. Robin Morgan, for example, the editor of Sisterhood is Powerful, was a friend of Carol Adams and encouraged her work and so on. Well, so that's the early 70s. Let's fast forward to the 2000s and see what happened. This is a different kind of song.
I am man, hear me roar, in numbers too big to ignore, and I'm way too hungry to settle for chick food. 'Cause my stomach's starting to growl, and I'm going on the prowl for a cheesy bacon XXL. Man, that's good. Oh, yes, I'm a guy. I'll admit I've been fed quiche. Way tofu, bye-bye. Now it's for flame-grilled beef I reach. I will eat this meat till my innie turns into an outie. I am star. I am incorrigible. big burger, beef, bacon, super cheesy, good thing now.
Cheesy Bacon XXL. Eat like a man, man.
Now that's actually a redo because that ad is so brilliant in so many ways semiotically that they brought it back. But the original end line was eat like a man. You know, so it was an ad for the Texas Whopper, not this cheesy bacon thing. We could talk about this ad for an hour or so. But basically, it was part of a backlash against feminism. Right, this is the 2000s. And since the 1980s, there's been a huge anti-feminist, misogynistic backlash that has now led to Trumpism, right? That's where we're at. So you have here a re-legitimation of meat, but it's after the feminist movement, so it's a parodic thing. In other words, there's a lot of making fun of masculinity at the same time that it's affirming it. So of course it begins with the vegan plate, which is like, you're gonna eat that, right? Some French foo-foo thing. You push that, you know, and then the men walk away from their girlfriends too. They're pushing away these things. Now, by the way, so the alt-right, just so you know, there's this whole discourse right of Carol Adams goes into the tofu, people who are vegetarians are emasculated. So this is a term that the alt-right uses, the white supremacist nationalist right, refers to their male critics as soy boys. So anyway, you have a kind of mass protest movement, I am man, I want my beef, and so forth. And here you have a kind of parody of Rosie the Riveter, right? Burning underwear instead of bras. A multicultural, you know, this is meat, is going to bring men together class and race, led by a white man, needless to say. Carol Adams pointed this out to me, the significance of the soccer mom van, right? The minivan, not the SUV. And this white guy, nerdy guy, is liberated. He's given a burger, and then they destroy this emblem of his emasculation, right? And then so eat this meat. All right. I don't have time to show it to you, but McDonald's has been using masculinity. This was an ad called Manly Men that ran in China, 2012. So masculinity is still used to legitimate violence against animals and to move commodities. Here's one: women will love you, men will want to be you, farm animals will fear you. This is the barbecues galore. So I don't mean to suggest in anything I'm saying today that hegemonic masculinity is still not driving the bus. But there has been a change in the culture around gender. Here's an ad I want to show you. This is 30 seconds. Whoops. Originally said, the tagline for that ad was originally "Restore Your Manhood," right? So again, there's playing with masculinity here, and there's a sense that, you know, you can't go back to the old John Wayne version. I mean, you can try to reinforce it, but it's not as self-evident and invisible as it used to be. Well, this brings us to the role of women, as particularly white women. And the New York Times ran this article a few years ago called "The Femivores Dilemma: Can Chicken Save the Desperate Housewife?" So here is a women, again, you know, women have had a lot of success in the women's movement in certain ways, you know, through Title IX, but as the Me Too movement has shown, you know, there's a lot of progress to be made. At any rate, as a strategy of legitimation, tying violence against animals to compassion has become the pivotal, I believe, the pivotal strategic discourse of the hour. And it's not people like Pollan who are pushing that. It is the women who are pushing it. Thousands and thousands of women who are becoming taxidermists, who are becoming butchers, who are becoming cattle ranchers, who are becoming chicken farmers. It's incredible how many women are being drawn into hobbies, industries, practices of herding and killing and dominating animals. So this is a book by Catherine Friend, The Compassionate Carnivore. Lear Keith, of course. I've learned to kill and I've learned to say my own grace. Keith, among many others, makes the case that you can't live, that it's an anti-feminist plot to have people eating meat because it damages women's bodies and so forth. I mean, to be vegetarians. So this is the sign of women's new empowerment. So there are. I wanted to introduce you to a term, the meat Bildungsroman, and the Bildungsroman was a novel in the 19th century that chronicled the self-actualization and the maturation process of a young man. And I'm using this term somewhat ironically to describe this whole new subgenre of nonfiction for women, of women who become butchers or especially farmers and then write memoirs about how liberating it was to go around dominating animals. And this is part of this resurgence of what I call neo-pastoralism, a new pastoralism, a romanticization of farming, but particularly animal farming. The first book in this genre, 2007, I believe, was Animal Vegetable Miracle by Barbara Kingsolver. It was one of the biggest bestsellers. I was on the New York Times bestseller list. Millions of people read this book. They're still reading Barbara Kingsolver's book. Animal Vegetable Miracle, you know, in the kind of ads that went for this book, is typically no representation of animals. But a lot of that book, like The Omnivore's Dilemma, was an attack on animal rights and a defense of animal agriculture. Ostensibly organic, small scale, but once you defend any form of animal agriculture, you end up defending everything. One point in the book, Barbara Kingsolver says, quote, killing is a culturally loaded term, so she doesn't want to use that. That isn't what goes on her farm, it's harvesting, right? Whereas harvest of animals implies planning, respect. It's a lot less fun than spending an autumn day picking apples off trees, but it's a similar operation on principle and the same word. And in another passage, I don't seem to be able to find at the moment, she criticizes vegetarians and animal rights people for being upset about cutting the heads off crops that blink their eyes, unquote, as opposed to cutting the heads off lettuces. Doesn't see any difference whatsoever. So there's this, the meat Bildungsroman, as I call it, or these memoirs by women, they are all about women's empowerment, woman-powered farm, one-woman farm, my life shared with sheep, pigs, chickens, goats, and a fiddle. Chickens in the Road by Susan McMinn, An Adventure of Ordinary Splendor. You see these women constantly cradling animals as though they're their babies, which I will come back to in a second, made from scratch, Chick Days, Barnhart, The Incurable Longing for a Farm of One's Own by Wogenrich. Well, of course, that term of a farm of one's own is an allusion to Virginia Woolf's very famous book, A Room of One's Own, which argued that women needed a space for themselves, both in society, you know, and in the home. And Woolf was very sympathetic to animal issues and, in fact, made this comment in Three Guineas, her anti-war book. Scarcely a human being in the course of history has fallen to a woman's rifle. The vast majority of birds and beasts have been killed by you, meaning men, not by us. So it's quite ironic, you know, that now women are wanting a farm of their own. They want their 40 acres, but the mule is the thing. These are not women who want just any kind of farm, a peach orchard or something. There have to be animals because it's quite important that they dominate them. Now, who are these women? Well, they are people like Susan McCorkendale, a senior marketing director at Family Circle, who describes feeling, quote, burned out, apathetic, and bored. So she and her husband leave their six-figure salaries and head down to, I believe, Virginia to buy a 500-acre beef farm. Similarly, Jessica Nadler, a senior editor with a women's magazine, exchanges her Manhattan life where she, quote, splurged on Miu Miu's, partied hard, and lived for Kahalini yoga for a life on a farm in the Badlands of Montana. I'm talking about dozens and dozens of books read by millions of women in this country, and all of them are about existential self-actualization. Jana Wogenrich, for example, describes Barnhart, as I said, as a condition suffered, quote, by those who wish to God we were outside with our flocks, feed bags, or harnesses instead of sitting in front of the computer screen. women who, quote, are overcome with the desire to be tagging cattle ears or feeding pigs. So for professional white women grown tired of having to please their boss 1 minute and having to rush home to start the second shift the next, controlling animals is a way, I argue, to escape feeling controlled themselves and a way to signal a kind of break with the corporate world and the conventional aspirations of their class and sex. Quote, I'm damn sure a ewe trying to deliver a lamb doesn't care about meeting a spreadsheet deadline, Jenna Wagenrich writes defiantly in her book, One Woman Farm. These women are tired of being tethered to the corporate machine, so now they're going to do the tethering themselves. Susan McMinn, in her book, Chickens in the Road, says, quote, milking a cow made me prove myself every single day. Her book is described as a coming-of-age story of a woman in her 40s, from publishing diva to reluctant pasture princess. Kristen Kimball, an Ivy Leaguer from an aristocratic East Coast family, effects a similar metamorphosis from a spoiled party girl to a down-home country gal by learning, quote, to shoot a gun, dispatch a chicken, dodge a charging bull, and ride out a runaway behind, ride out a runaway behind panicked horses. So I could give you other examples of this, but in many of the memoirs, the women dominate a horse or another large animal as a way of feeling empowered. Thus, McMinn writes, quote, I rise up on the big pasture from the back of a horse, and in my hands, I hold the reins. And Kimball similarly observes about mastering a horse, quote, it means you're on top, a position of power, right? So here are, you know, again, there are dozens of these books. The Dirty Life, dirtiness signifies violence, actually, in these. The Call of the Farm, an unexpected year of getting dirty, home cooking, and finding myself, again, existential. Self-making, Confessions of a Counterfeit Farm Girl, a follow-up book, Righteous Pork Shop by Nicolette Nyman, who was a supposed vegetarian who started cattle ranching, organic cattle ranching, and she and her husband, a capitalist, made millions of dollars from that. A lot of these books have to do with the women's romances, which blur with kind of eroticizing death, destruction. Now, the best title of all is by Kathy Rudy, a women's studies professor at Duke University, who entitled her book, which is about criticizing animal rights and defending killing animals to eat them, loving animals, of course. Now, Joel Salatin of Polyface Farms, Michael Pollan, the men who support locavorism, carnal locavorism, they do not use these metaphors I'm going to go into in a moment of maternalism and natality. That's Michael Pollan on the left with a dead pig, right? Because they don't need to do that. They're men and straight men at that, and that kind of is their, its own justification for what they do. But you find with the female, these women, these memoirists, that they constantly talk about their treatment of animals in terms of maternalism. I can only give you a couple of examples, but there are, you know, dozens or hundreds. Quote, our turkeys would be pampered as children, Barbara Kingsolver writes. April 23, my babies are due, she writes on her calendar before the chicks that she's ordered arrive. She says, speaking of her daughter Lily, she talks about these chicks as a lesson in maternal responsibility for her daughter. Catherine Friend in Hit by a Farm says, we could make babies after she and her partner, a woman, buy a farm in Minnesota to raise sheep. Another writer puts a, quote, basket of gear and supplies by her back door, like, quote, a hospital suitcase for a mother in waiting and for a midwife preparing for midnight delivery, unquote. For the author of Mud Boots, the decision to foster a little girl and a little boy, unquote, that is baby lambs, fills its author with anxiety because, quote, it has been a long time since I had a baby. And then when the babies are born, the women are over the moon. Catherine Friend burbles, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, we'd made a baby boy. And the memoirs describe pastures and birthing season as nurseries, quote unquote, out of control daycare centers. Herding little lambs is said to resemble, quote, a fire drill in a kindergarten. At any rate, I could give you many examples of that, but for lack of time, I'm going to have to go on. So there again, Diana Rogers, the maternal theme. Well, this is all well and good, but then there will indeed be blood. sadism and a kind of death fetishism. The only way that these women can achieve any kind of existential ballast, it turns out, is through shedding blood, through domination and hurting these other animals. That becomes their signifier or symbol of authenticity and self-actualization. And so in the Femivores, loving maternalism, woe be unto the objects of mommy's love. Catherine Friend says, I clung fiercely to this tender animal. She's talking about a newborn lamb. I clung fiercely to this tender animal in my arms, wanting to protect her from whatever dangers lay ahead. Every danger, of course, except her own person, the super predator, right? An unusually affectionate lamb proves so smitten with Catherine Friend that he follows her around, precociously demanding to be nuzzled and pet on his head. So Friend dubs him, quote, Mr. Playful, and tells her partner, I feel like kissing him right on his nose. Then in a few weeks comes the butcher. These three men show up in a truck, and she has the Mr. Playful slaughtered. She sits in her pickup and cries, and then she eats him and says, boy, you know, he's so good, savory and incredibly tender. And she says in the book, meat comes from animals that have died. Plain and simple. That have died, right? This is typically, go on the internet, you just see this, you know, and the other speakers have highlighted this, the kind of betrayal and hypocrisy. So this is this new symbol of women's empowerment. Novella Carpenter, a local here in Oakland, particularly vicious. Gabriel Hamilton talks about sending the baby lambs on her farm, quote, with their little crooked sets of teeth and milky eyes, unquote, to her favorite butcher to be killed, after which their corpses are, quote, tied onto 10-foot poles made of ash, because branches of an ash tree grow so straight that you can skewer a baby lamb with them easily. Sounding almost like a proud soccer mom, Hamilton writes, quote, we roasted four or five of the little guys whole. The lambs were arranged over the coals, head to toe, the way you'd put a bunch of kids having a sleepover to bed, unquote. A blissful image of maternal watchfulness, which is, however, followed in the next sentence by Hamilton by her description of the lamb's blood, quote, dripping down into the coals with a hypnotic and rhythmic bliss. Hiss, hiss, hiss. To the Femivore memoirists' feigned surprise, they discover that killing animals isn't as bad as they thought it would be. Quote, it's intense and not at all enjoyable, Wagenrich owns, but, quote, not upsetting. After Susan McMinn traps a raccoon one night, she takes her son's .22 and shoots the helpless animal to death as he cowers in his cage. Quote, wow, she reflects afterwards, I felt strange. I just killed an animal. I felt good and bad at the same time. But basically, they feel very good. Novella Carpenter, the local urban farmer, musing about a pig she is set to kill, writes in her book, quote, I was going to have to kill one of Simon's babies. And it is hard not to picture Carpenter smiling to herself as she thinks it. After raising her first pigs, Carpenter later remarks to her friend, yeah, I got to find someone to execute those fuckers. Though she would prefer, quote, to kill the pigs myself, Carpenter decides to let a professional handle it, since the pigs now weigh 300 pounds each. Quote, I really want to see the pigs die, she explains to the butcher she takes them to, a woman named Sheila. But Sheila ends up killing the pigs without her. This so infuriates Carpenter, missing the execution, that after hearing the news, she slams down the phone and screams, cunt. I'm sorry, but she does. An undertow of homicidal fury continually tugs at the memoir's cheerfully flowing banter. After an opossum breaks into an enclosure one night, wreaking havoc on the poultry pen, Carpenter seeks vengeance and finds it. Quote, channeling my rage, remembering the cuteness of my ducks and the goose who would rest her head in my lap, I raised the shovel and came down on the opossum's neck. After a few more thrusts, and I admit it, grunts, head separated from body, I had my bloody revenge. Later, she reflects, quote, caught up in protecting my babies, I realized I had become a savage. Yet the same author's determination to protect her babies at all costs vanishes just a few weeks later when she carries a beautiful white duck, trusting and docile, into her house, places him in a bathtub full of water, and murders him. Quote, he quacked and swam around for a few minutes, she writes, while I collected my arsenal, a tree pruner. Quote, I merely squeezed the loppers shut. The duck went from being a happy camper to being a headless camper, Carpenter writes. I plucked and eviscerated him outside on a table. So you see these flippant descriptions of extreme violence and a kind of mockery of the animals' deaths. I don't have time to go into them, but the women laugh at the impending doom of the animals, who of course don't know what's going to go on, what's happening to them. There's also a disturbing link between the killing and sexuality, the women's sexuality. They become sexually aroused at the sight of animal flesh. For example, Novella Carpenter, she supposedly was a vegetarian, but then one day the vegetarian goes away when she finds herself, quote, dizzy with desire, unquote, at the sight of a ceiling-high stack of bacon. Her pork lust, as she calls it, drives her to a frenzy. Seeing the corpses of the first pigs that she's had killed, she impulsively reaches over and scoops some of the raw brains into her mouth with her bare hands, like Hannibal Lecter in overalls. Delicious, she pronounces. Kimball, in her book, goes out with her husband, and they end up, you know, bonding and having sex over, you know, killing animals. Mark and I, she writes, moved through the steps of slaughter gracefully, a coordinated team of two. Mark handed me the gun, I handed him the knife. They sneak up on Kathleen, their cow, whom they find grazing quietly in a field. They shoot her in the head and slash her throat open. Quote, the hot blood poured out on the grass. She bled and kicked, parody of flight. Her eyes blank. I wrapped a chain around one of her hind legs, and then she kicked again. I held the leg for a moment, felt the strength seep from the big muscles. It takes time to drain all the life from a living thing, as though life were a substance. This is lovemaking for Kimball. Spilling blood is foreplay in the book to intercourse, matrimony, and self-overcoming. Lily McAlew, the journalist turned big game hunter, says, don't you have to tie off the anus and penis first? This is what she says to her husband lovingly in the middle of the woods as they kneel before the warm corpse of an elk McAlew has just killed. And moments before this pillow talk, the blissful couple have been crawling through the muck of a damp forest together, chasing down the mortally wounded elk McAlew has shot through the heart. Later, the lovers, quote, lift our forks, raise our glasses, and make a simple toast loaded with thanks to our elk. One elk, one kill, one heart. Jenna Wagenrich writes, hand me a bow and arrow or a rifle, and it makes sense. I could give many other examples of the way, for the women, firearms and any kind of instrument of destruction becomes a kind of an eroticized instrument. They become warlike. They end up taking tokens off of their victims' bodies. For example, wearing pigtails, their pigtails adorned with chicken and goose feathers whom they've killed. McAlew, her first kill, she takes the bird's feathers and makes a styrofoam ball, puts them in a styrofoam ball to make as a Christmas ornament. McAlew, by the way, the first time she kills an animal feels a sense of euphoria. Driving home, she writes, I roll down the windows, crank up the radio, and sing at the top of my lungs. Like a man boasting about having deflowered his first virgin, McAlew writes, quote, that no other kill evokes such pure elation as the first. Soon, she graduates from killing birds and small mammals, rabbits, ducks, partridges, to large mammals. One ecstatic afternoon, she finds herself, she writes, kneeling before a bull elk, up to my shoulders in blood, quote, drenched in blood and laughing at her earlier squeamishness. Well, kind of to bring things more or less to a close, all of these discourses are, of course, legitimating carnal locavorism, sustainable meat, humane meat, but they're also legitimating animal agriculture as a whole. They're affirming the killing over and over again of billions and billions of animals for eternity, and that's something to keep in mind. Anytime somebody defends the killing of a chicken on their little farm, they're saying this is okay for humans to do forever. So it isn't, we were speaking of scale earlier, I think maybe in Justin's talk. Well, the scale is always cosmic in dimension. Justin, is Justin here?
Yeah, I'm up here.
So Justin, you know, you were mentioning Meredith Lee. So this strange death fetishism takes quite an interesting turn in Meredith Lee's ethical meat handbook. where she, well, let's see if I can find it. Gosh, it's really worth your while if I can find it. Sorry about that. Oh, no, that's not it. Yeah, no, that's not it. Nope, that's not it. Oh, here it is. So Meredith Lee in this book talks about having spent the day killing animals, and she says, "We separate heads and hearts. We roll fleeces for later washing and tanning. We slaughter two more lambs, Maybelle and Whiteface. We share silence and sadness each time. Each time I feel my breathing, and I feel gratitude for precious life as well as for suffering. I think I could stand to die here. Here in this pasture, under these mountains, this sky. If, when my time comes, someone lays me down in green grass and soothes my body, and someone I love then lovingly cuts my throat, and my blood runs into the grass and fertilizes the soil, and my body is used for food and necessity, I could handle that." Well, I sense there are some volunteers in the audience. Well, these discourses are being used also by the fact, quote, factory farming intensified agriculture people. Guess what? So Judith Capper, a livestock sustainability consultant, so-called, to the U.S. cattle industry, writes that the beef industry needs to, quote, specifically target the female consumer, quote, unquote, because women still make the bulk of food buying decisions. Convincing women to buy meat is vital, she says, because of that female-to-female connection that promotes an instant degree of trust. In the past, of course, you had Frank Perdue and his laboratory, you know, white coat and so forth, symbolizing male authority, but that won't cut it anymore, she says. And she writes in her blog, quote, do moms have instant beef credibility? And she talks about her own pregnancy, and she talks about how her, quote, baby bump has given her more opportunities for conversations about the importance of beef in pregnancy nutrition and so forth. In her travels, she says, the most popular question I have heard at conferences is still, how do you communicate this information to the consumer, swiftly followed by, when is your baby due? Now, so there she is, the hack for the cattle industry. I don't have time to go into it, but Temple Grandin is a kind of bridge between these two worlds. She's lionized by the organic and small farm community, and then also by intensified agriculture. I don't have time to go into that. But note that the culture she's the epitome of femininity in this new era. She's a mass killer. Well, what could be better? You have Claire Danes play her in the film Temple Grandin. As folks have pointed out, Karen pointed out, animal compassion, this is the Whole Foods aisle. This stuff works, and it's incredibly effective. Here's total U.S. Organic sales growth. Organic meat, poultry, and seafood. Look from 2005 down to 2013. That's the picture. This is the same overseas as well. Now, why has all this occurred? It's too much for me to get into exactly, but as I said at the outset, women have felt, come against a kind of glass ceiling, and we find representations in the culture of kick-ass heroines, women and girls who are appropriating supposedly kind of patriarchal tools of power, the gun, the knife, the bow and arrow, like the Hunger Games. You all know the Hunger Games franchise. Kelly Oliver, in her book Hunting Girls, points out the following, and I think this applies also to what we're seeing in animal agriculture. Quote, animals become the sacrificial lambs and scapegoats for a patriarchal culture that debases women and girls. Killing instead of loving animals has become the emblem of girl power. Just as girls are hunted and attacked with relish in these films, our heroines displace that patriarchal violence onto their animal prey. In these hunting fantasies, empowerment is seen as much in terms of violence as any other form of resistance. They serve as compensatory fantasies for girls and young women subjected to violence, especially sexual violence, in their everyday lives. Our new kick-ass heroines aren't going to take it lying down. Bloodied and bruised, they will go on fighting. So there's Katniss, the predatorial Katniss from Hunger Games, which, by the way, is inspiring a resurgence of girls young girls in hunting across the country. That's one of the biggest growth areas in national hunting, is girls and young women. Now, we have models in our culture, of course, of empathy and compassion for animals. This is Hurricane Katrina, the rescue efforts. We have this wonderful picture of Karen Davis and her turkey. This is Jenny Brown of Woodstock Sanctuary, Patrice Jones of Vine Sanctuary, Robert Grillo of Free From Harm, Kim Stallwood, you may know him. So, you know, we have other models of connecting to the animal world, obviously, other than hurting and maiming them. But the takeaway from this talk is that what the femivores are doing, these women who are being drawn into dominating and hurting animals, is they are taking from us and from society one of the last resources that we have for resisting oppression, patriarchal oppression, capitalism, everything, which is to say empathy. They are conflating empathy with murder. They are conflating killing with caring. That is so dangerous. Now, it isn't up, by the way, to the women, like, you know, some of the slides I showed you there, to take up the slack. The men have to step forward, too, and show that empathy isn't simply a feminine virtue, right? It's something that all humans are capable of and must affirm. Thank you very much.